stuff.
Yeah.
And
filing
and faxing and computing and...
And you get home.
Yeah.
And, you know, the
what do you get?
The woman.
What do you get?
The mother, you know. And the you just... Oh.
And they always come up with the same thing.
Dumb sayings.
I've been slaving over a hot stove all day.
Yeah. Why just stick your head in the fridge?
Sort yourself out.
And how hot can a microwave get?
Yeah. And what about that other one? You get home and you got the slaving over the hot stove thing, and then do you get the one where it?
So they tell you about it to give you a headache because misery loves company.
Yeah. Well, what about that one, you come in through the door and you leave the door open.
Oh, yeah.
What is that one?
I'm not trying to air condition the entire neighbourhood.
You are. Well, I am.
What were you, born in a tent? Well,
yes, I was. You know, this is crazy, insane. And,
what about that one? Don't pick
your nose. Who else is going to do it?
Yeah! Gosh, and the other one,
why do you keep scratching yourself there? Yeah, because I'm the only one who knows religion.
That's right!
No respect for a guy who's been out working hard all day. All they want to do, it's always me, me, me. I want to complain about this, I want to complain about that. What about me? I'm at a day.
Yes.
Thank you. these are my children, Adam, Georgie and Hugh. During this time in our service, we take up our tithes and offerings. Now, if you're a visitor here with us tonight, there is no expectation that you place anything in our offering bags. This special event that we have for you is a gift to you. Our fellowship is committed to the giving of tithes. Now, while this is happening, I'd like to ask you to pray for the offering.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you have provided for us. We pray that the money that has been given today will be used for the glory of the kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Thanks,
Jude. Now, after our service tonight, we'd like to welcome you back to our foyer for a cup of tea or coffee. And next week, we have another special event. Thanks, Adam. These are good helpers up here. And at 10:30 next Sunday morning, we have a special event titled Where Your Heart Is, There Will Be Your Treasure. So we'd love to see you back for that. Now, right now, Adam and Georgie are going to share something with you.
Hi, I'm Adam. I'm going to tell you what my mum means to me. She cooks for me. She asks me about my day at school, and because I know that she loves me, she does my washing when I'm watching TV. She helps me with my homework. She watches my rugby games whenever she can. She prays with me.
Hi, my name is Georgie. My mum is a great mum. She cares about other people. She watches my mother takes me to dancing. She looks after me when I'm sick. When I'm lonely, she prays me. She takes me to church. She prays with me.
Thanks,
guys.
I think good children. I'm sure every mother can relate to those bullet points that our kids have shared with me tonight. Next up, we have the congregational song, and this is your chance to participate in our service. So I'm going to ask you to stand, please, and welcome on the music team.
Okay, we can do the song. Yeah, thank you.
mountains, don't you agree?
Yes.
And God's prayer helps us in this area by directing us in how we bring our children. Let's see what God's word says.
Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honour your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you, and that you may enjoy long life on the earth.
Amen.
Be quiet now.
being a mum can be really hard, especially when you're not feeling well. I sort of see, I guess, two things I really stood out with my children. One thing that right early on when I took children was the minister's wife, this was at a retreat, and I was saying, you know, enjoy your children, the gospel outside of them. I'm a little at that time, like, yes. I really took that to heart, and I thought, yes, I'm going to enjoy my children. And as most of you know, mine are going to be 18 and 20 next month, so the years have just gone by so fast. And so something I'd really like to say is enjoy your children, and that's what I really wanted to do with them, and have fun with them, and to really build good memories into their lives. And I think it's important to recognise the different stages that they go through and to enjoy each stage as they go through it. You know, they start off as babies and it just seems never ending. You're getting up at night time, you're changing nappies and they're feeding. And in between you've got to put meals, do the washing and try and sort of keep the house tiny. And it just seems that, you know, it's sort of like six times a day you're going through that cycle of feeding, napping, changing nappies and putting down feed, and it's no longer just seems a few minutes to wake again and start all over again, six times a day. And I think the hardest thing for me was getting up in the middle of the night and, and it can seem really hard, but I think, you know, looking back, they're the times when you can have the most cuddles out of your babies and your children, you know. You can cuddle them as much as you like then, and really take the time in cuddling your baby and spending time with it. You know, and I really look back now too, and I think, you know, God was very wise. Every time we had to sit down and feed them, we get to sit down, and then six times a day, that you actually sort of took time out and actually sat down with your baby. And that, in a way, almost refreshed you in a way. So don't. They grow some babies very fast. In a year's time, they'll find their feet and they're off walking and learning new things. And then you're into the preschool age, the toddler age. And I've heard so many parents say that terrible terms. You know, I really enjoy the toddler stage. They're learning so much. Yes, they do try you out. They do try and find their boundaries. And I think as long as you're firm with them and show them where boundaries are, just really enjoy them. They're exploring. You know, they just learn so much, learn new things, exploring everything. If I can remember, it used to take half an hour just to go one block to the shop. For one particular child, you know, it's just looked at every single insect, every worm, every ladybird, every leaf had to be inspected along the way. And so, just enjoy that time. It's a time of learning for them, and you can put so much into their lives as you spend that time with them. And then very soon, they're off to school, and that's a hard time, sort of, same vibe for them, and they're off to school. And, you know, but it's those are years when they're really full of imagination, full of play, life's one big play. And, you know, I really miss the time of going to the park and playing on the swings. I miss those times. I've got no excuse to go to the park anymore. You know, so make the most of that time, going to the parks, having walks, going to the swimming pool, to the zoo, and all those fun things that you can do with kids. And when it's rainy days, we used to get out all the blankets, all the sheets, we drove all the lounge full of the armchairs, make tents, and we used to have, I can remember the lounge being, well, a whole city of, well, it's a whole tent city actually, in blankets. We used to have our meals underneath there, and, you know, there's actually, one thing I'm very thankful for, we never had a TV until the kids were in their teens, actually, and so they really had to use their imagination, and so we had great fun using our imagination too. And enjoy your children. And as they got a wee bit older, they start learning to cook. And that was great, having breakfast and bed, cups of tea and bed. It doesn't happen so much now, I must admit, they've got beyond that. So just enjoy it while you do have it. I'm thinking, oh, this is going to last, but it doesn't last. So enjoy it. And of course, then you're into
And then I guess very soon they'll be gone from home. I'm not looking forward to that, but I must admit. And I guess the second real goal I had, as well as enjoying my children, was to there's a verse in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 6, which I just like to read out. And I thought of this was very important. In fact, these verses are actually repeated in Deuteronomy more than once. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. I thought it was really important to teach my children about the Lord. That's different from preaching. I used to, each day, especially since they were born, on the first day they were born, I prayed with them and I sang Christian songs with them. I guess their favourite right through childhood was Jesus loves me, this I know. Well, the Bible tells me so, I am weak, but he is strong, Jesus loves me. And another one was to sing, may the Lord bless you and keep you, may his face shine upon you. And we always used to sing those when they went to bed, and there's a number of other ones they used to like to choose. And I think it's very important to talk about the Lord. And as I said, that's not preaching, but just like if you have needs and say, oh look, let's pray about this. And when they're sick, well, let's pray that Jesus will make you better. When they've woken up with really bad dreams, pray that God will bring them peace. And he does. And I can remember clearly when we were going to the Philippines, and I remember we didn't have Gary's fear, let alone my fear. One morning I woke up and it was like God told me, today I'm going to give you $2,000 for your fear. And I can remember saying to the children, you know, I'm pretty sure God told me that he's going to give me $2,000 today for my fear. And I'm really glad I told them, because at the end of the day, I said, do you know what I said to you this morning? And they said, yes, God was going to give you $2,000 for your fear. And I said, well, that happened. You know, it's important to really talk about the Lord. Bring your needs before the Lord. You know, if they need something, well, let's pray about it. You know, I can remember when Adele was, when she started school at Cannon's Creek, she found it very hard to make friends. So that summer when she was six, we really prayed that she would find a friend. And we made it a real quick point that summer. And that was when the socks moved in across the road that summer. And Sarah and her ended up in the same house and became friends. You know, that was a real answer to prayer. And, you know, just always, everything, time and effort, I guess, pray about it. And, so that would be my two keys. Enjoy your children and talk about the Lord with them. Whenever, just naturally, just, yeah. And also it's important, too, before they went to bed, always, I mean, like when they were little, and when they were preschool age, and then we used to just read a little story about Jesus and something from the Bible. And as they got older, we used to have little Bible reading notes, and then it was back in the teens. They were able to do that own. So I think it's important to remember those two things. Enjoy your children and meet them in the knowledge of the Lord. Take them on board, you know what I mean? hospitality and free for friends. Giving, if you ask the price, etc., few people give them. very generous. Puts us first. Hard working, helps hold the family together, dinner, games, etc. Talks with us. Friendly with our friends. Tolerant extremely. Loves loss. That's good. Not perfect, never other children. Patient extremely. Ready to apologise. And then the bond says, I love you, Mum. We knew we were loved. So,
about it, really. Good books I'm talking about, the attempts at books, but often I have felt when I've looked at some of the books that they've been kind of a little bit, I would say shallow. Even some of the women that have written the books have not done a good job. Because it's not because they haven't tried hard. It's because I think mothers have a lot more value than our society places on them. Have you ever been guided by your mother's voice of wisdom in your head as you've grown older? Some of you are still children, so you'll still get it. You know, don't do that! Rings in your head. Don't put that in your mouth. You don't know where it's been. You're going to poke your eye up with that thing. Eat those carrots. They're good for your eyes. Have you ever seen a rabbit wearing glasses? Then you come into the kitchen looking all refreshed and she says, did you flush? Always the little things that she cared about. There's enough dirt in those ears for potatoes to grow. I always remember my mum, she was still trying to help me when I'd become more than a teenager. First time I ever shaved, and I didn't shave as early as some guys because I've been a little fella for so long and the hair didn't grow on my face very much, it's made up for it since, but there it was. And my mother decided that she was still wanting to help me, so she watched me trying to shave. And she got frustrated because she'd watched Dad for years. In fact, she may have been secretly shaving, I don't know. And she came over to me and she said, hey, you're doing it all wrong. She'd give me the razor. So I did. It was one of those shick things. The old shicks. Some of you remember them? Single-bladed things. It was fresh, it was brand new, it was my first razor. So she gets a thing and she gets it on my face and she goes, flick down it just like Dad did. And a big gush of blood shot out from her face. At that point I think my mum realised I didn't need any more sort of serious help of that nature. There was great apologies and bits of toilet paper stuck on my face when I thought I needed plasters. Then there's other saying, something like this. Some mothers say, I hope when you grow up that you have children just like you. That'll be revenge. Then the other ones, the common ones that you get. You're putting too much salt on. I was amused tonight, this lunchtime day, right, this afternoon when we had a meal. Eventually a whole lot of people gathered, young people gathered at our place to have Chorda's birthday. It was his happy birthday, Chorda, and anybody else's birthday day. It was funny, though, watching them, because I heard one of their mothers speaking through their lips. As one of them was shaking salt on, there was another one in the other room who says something about how much salt you're putting on your food. And I thought, there goes somebody's mum. And so I whispered to the person shaking the salt, I said, just as well they couldn't see me doing it. Because mum said the same thing. You know, there's something about mothers that are special. I didn't appreciate my mother until way too late. And I think a lot of us are like that, and I think we need to make up time for it where we've lost out. I've been seeking to do so. I There are times when I've really felt for my mum since I've gotten older and since I've gotten married and realised I must have been a bit of a pain at times. It's kind of amusing. My uncle gave me electronics gear and my mother says, "What are you going to let junk sitting around there for him, Eric? You only give him rubbish." Well, it was one of my best birthday presents, but my mother had to live with the junk ever after. And some of you that have been into my office recently know how easily that can happen. But we are moulded by our mothers, we are shaped by our mothers. And it's a God-given role of a mother, and of course a father, but tonight we just forget about the fathers, just for tonight. Mothers impact us all. We've all had them. None of us have been able to bypass that course. Sometimes they've had us, and sometimes they think they've had us. Sometimes they think they've had enough of us. But nonetheless, they still love us. And some of us here are mothers. My wife, sometimes in the past, has gotten down on herself and said, "No, she didn't think she did a very good job of things." We all do that. I don't matter whether fathers or mothers, we all do that sometimes. But my wife, as she shared with you tonight, my girls will tell you that she's there. She's there for them as a mother, and she's there for all of us as a family. And I want to just tonight quickly go over some pointers about mothers. I gave you a nice looking mother there. The original version on the computer was actually taller, which made her rather slim, so I thought, well, that's not good because that's not quite normal. In fact, it was quite anorexic looking, so I just sort of shrunk it a bit that way, and it looks better that way, eh? But the power of woman is incredible. Think about it. Think about the power of the woman. The woman, from nappies to teenage years to trying to tame her husband as a mother, has a huge role to play. You know, right from the early days in the Bible, mothers were often the influence on their sons in making major decisions. I got really annoyed a few years ago when the feminist movement got really up to high power, high esteem, and some of them became very critical of the Bible and said it was a male-dominated document. Yes. I could agree with them on one side, it was a male-dominated document, and the fact that it talked a lot about the failures of men. Very few women were seen as failures in the Bible. Most of the women in the Bible, and by the way, most women were expected to be mothers in the Bible, they weren't expected to be single in those days. The mothers had incredible influence on their children. Powerful influence that changed nations' histories at times. Not always for the best, but most often for the best. And when we come to mothers, I think one of the things we need to do is we need to come to an appreciation of their strength and their courage. See, guys are prone towards feeling that they're strong. A woman are actually strong. I want to say that. My daughter's getting a wee bit carried away there. When I went through the shingles pain, which lasted for quite a few years for me, when I went through the worst point of it, the doctor said to me, "The pain you're going through now," and it was acute in my face, extremely acute. So that's the same level approximately of what every woman goes through every time they have childbirth. Now, not every woman does go through that extreme pain, I know, because I think one or two said they had virtually no pain. In fact, as my friend the doctor said, they pop their sprogs so they can't catch them. So, in the Bible, these women are clearly portrayed as women of strength and women of power, women of courage. And I think sometimes we allow society to push women down, and we shouldn't do that. Amen? If you want to agree, you can say amen. That just means I agree. There are three women I want to pick up on tonight. There was Naomi, Esther, and Mary. Naomi was a woman who had lost her sons when she went to another land to escape a famine. She returned after losing her sons, and she had two daughters-in-law. Both of them offered to travel with her and to stay with her. Only Ruth stayed. Naomi selflessly, she could have held Ruth close to her. She could have said, you spend all your time with me and you just be with me. But she encouraged her to find another man for a husband. And of course, she found Boaz, who happened to be a relation of Naomi's. Now, when she went, she didn't know this Ruth didn't. But this Ruth was a woman who became a godly woman, who by the example of a mother of the sons of one of the sons that she married, had been so godly that she wanted to follow this mother, Naomi, her mother-in-law. Then there's Esther. Esther, who ended up in the queen as a Jewess, and there was anti-Semitic feelings led by a guy called Mordecai. And they were out to kill the Jew. Sorry, not Mordecai. Haman, sorry. Someone clicking or something was wrong. And as her life was at risk, she could have just lain quiet. She could have just shut up, because as a queen she would have been safe. But it was her uncle, Mordecai, who said to her, you need to change. You need to go. You need to do something about this. And Esther, at the risk of her life, because she could have been killed. You see, even if she was a queen, by entering her husband's presence in the way that she did, she could have been, in the old tradition of the laws of the day, she could have lost her life. But she put her life on the line for the sake of her people. Here was a woman of courage. And then there was the Mary, the mother of Jesus, and the other woman who were hanging out with her at the time when Jesus died on the cross. Who were the ones who were there? John and a whole bunch of women. Mary being one of them. Mary, as Jesus grew up, treasured the things in her heart, the scripture says. Treasured the things in her heart about Jesus. You heard Pauline talking about some of her little treasures, and she didn't talk half as much. She would love to have probably said one or two other things, but she may have gotten in trouble with our daughters. But there are special moments in our lives. And for mothers, we have a responsibility in terms of that. We have a clear responsibility if we're mothers. And this doesn't cause the men to, it's gone from responsibility. And please, if I hear of any guy, I don't care whether you belong to this church or not, any guy that goes home and slams his wife who's a mother and saying, you should be doing this, I would love to pat you on the backside over my knee. This is not what this is all about tonight. This is for you, if you're a guy, to appreciate the woman in your life. Yes?
Amen.
Not to go tanning on. But there is a responsibility, and we mustn't avoid the issue of responsibility here. There's a responsibility of ours in terms of our mums, and there's really a responsibility of our mums. It doesn't matter how old our children are, we still have responsibility. Now, sure, we may not be able to tell them what to do anymore, and of course, Yvonne could get away with what she did tonight because she didn't get told anymore. But we are still there to be an influence, no matter who we are. See, as a mother, we're also, some of us here, wives. Some of us here are mothers on our own. And I want to applaud those that have had to cope with being mothers on their own. Well, somebody got up this morning, Tim got up and spoke about his mum. He lost a husband tragically some years ago, back in 1987, I think he said. And she's coped with three children. That's a tough deal to be mother and father to three children. And I think she's done a pretty good job with them, quite frankly. I told her that recently. You know? A mother can determine the difference between heaven and hell for their children. A mother can determine that. And for their children's friends. If you want to know why I think my daughters, both of my daughters, in fact, Sola as well now, she's part of our family, why they are people who are keen to serve God and love God and share the things of God, and why they have lives that are encouraging. They still go through the teenage years, like Pauline said, trying the boundaries. Yes, I was intrigued to hear that Johanna said that she thought that Mum was really, what was the word? Lenient. Pauline always thought she was so mean and bossy sometimes. It's nice to hear it. It's good to see them like they are. And the reason they're like they are is because, not sure, I've had some input too, but Pauline has been there when I haven't been able to be there at times. And that's been hard sometimes. It's been the odd occasion when I've been away, like I remember one situation, I was in Christchurch, got a phone from Pauline and she put one of the girls on the telephone so I could have a talk to them. She wasn't getting through. Yes, we had those moments. But Pauline knew what to do. And sometimes she needed to call me in. But basically, she has treasured the precious things in the lives of her children, just like Mary did about Jesus. So there are four things I want to finish with tonight. The first thing is what Pauline said. You should enjoy your children, doesn't matter how young or old they are. Enjoy them. I see Pat, she's a grandmother. Won't be too many years, she could be a great-grandmother. It's true. But she's been enjoying them. I saw her just before, one of them come clambering around her back. She voices them over the chair, and her back has disappeared again, but there he was. Come and gone. But you've got to enjoy them. You see, if you don't intentionally set out to really enjoy your children, you're only going to become the dominator. And if you become a dominator, then the children will reject you. They will. And if you think back, you may have made some real serious mistakes. Don't go beating up on yourselves on it. Just go to them and say, look, I'm really sorry. I've realised where I've gone wrong, and I'm really sorry, and I really want to pick up from this day onwards, and I want to enjoy you because I love you. And all the things in the past I've said where I've blown it, please forgive me. You're still the mother of your children. And they'll love you for it. The second thing I'd like to talk about is giving your children purpose in life. If you're just allowing your children to grow up and do the things that every other child does, then you're failing to give them real purpose. There are times when you do need to call the shots and say, there are lines, there are boundaries. You know, when Pauline talked about going down the street and it took half an hour to get one block, that was fine because they were looking at caterpillars, leaves and stones and fences and all the rest of it. At night when she would pray with them, both of them used to have these long extended prayers. Dear Lord, I pray for the butterflies and the teddy and granddad, and I pray for my teddy bear and I pray for... We can get all theological about it and say, you don't pray for those things, don't be so stupid. It wasn't the issue. What was happening here wasn't correction, getting everything correct and perfect. What was actually happening here, really what was happening here, is that the daughters were saying, I like to pray with Mum and I like to do it long as I can so I can stay up as late as I can with them. Isn't that true? Yeah. But what's wrong with that? It's usually only 3 or 4 extra minutes. And it's worth it in the long run because when you see your daughters praying, then it's worth it. And that leads me to my next point. Pray with the children. You heard Pauline talk about praying? You may not be used to praying with the children. I had some parents we met called the Bleakers. Unusual name, but that's what their surname was. It's like Colville's an unusual name, I guess. They lived in Australia, and their little wee one came home from Sunday school because they used to send them to Sunday school because they get rid of them on Sunday morning like my parents did. But their little wee one, I always remember, she was only a wee top. She came home asking big, big questions. So Mum and Dad wanted to, with sincerity, answer the questions, so they went to the local Anglican vicar of the Sunday school that they'd been attending. And they said, can you answer these questions for us? As a consequence, The vicar said, you need to know Jesus and you need to learn to talk with your children about God and you need to pray. And their whole lives turned upside down. And they said to us, they had incredible pleasure being parents, more than they'd ever known before, all because of the spiritual discovery. Now, it happened to be that it was a child leading the parents, but really the responsibility is for the parents to be leading the children, is it not? The mother we're going to focus on tonight, but also the father. So pray, and it may seem like a stupid little thing. I remember one prayer that backfired badly on Pauline. Johanna said, can I have a goat? And Pauline said, no, you can't have a goat. We don't live in an area where you can have a goat. So Johanna was, she'd learned from Pauline how to pray, you see. So she said to Pauline, she said, if I pray for a goat and God gives me a goat, can I have a goat? And she's so Pauline feeling really confident that God wasn't going to give her a goat. Said, sure, if God gives you a goat, you can have a goat. 3 days later, I think it was, somewhere around about then, Pauline opens the back door, and there's an Angora goat standing on the back doorstep looking at her. No kidding. Johanna prayed for a goat. Now, it did take them a couple of hours or so running around the lake trying to catch it before they finally caught it, but they got it. And she asked God for it, and she got what she asked for. Powerful lessons in prayer that Pauline didn't even take so seriously. But it happened. We had this jolly goat everywhere. Some of you knew this goat. It would follow you around. Johanna would come home and it could hear her coming. She would carry this goat in her arms. Even when it got big, she'd pick it up all four legs and carry this goat, you know, put it down. No wonder she's got strong muscles, you know. But really, it was a lesson of prayer. And if you teach your children to pray, God will always give what they ask. See, children, when they pray, they do it in faith. We tend to doubt too much, don't we, as adults? So mothers, fathers too need to think of it, but mothers today we're focusing on, pray with your children. Teach them how to pray. And then lastly, is teach them. Don't just teach them how to pray. Teach them about the love of God. Teach them what it is to know His word. And there's only one way you can do that. And that's to know Him yourself. There's only one way you can do it. You might only be half a step ahead of your children, but you can get down and start to discover what He talks about. You see, God gave us the responsibility of motherhood. And with that responsibility comes an accountability to Him. That's a serious side. Not a downside, as some people think. There are things that will help. We use some books, a couple of books. Can't remember what it's called, How to Raise Your Children and How to Raise Your Teenagers or something like that. Two different books by Dobson. Just little wee books, but boy, were they helpful. There are other things we learned over the years by talking with other people. But it will only happen. A really healthy life for your children will only happen out of the wellspring of the life that you discover. And if it's a shallow well that's only living for the life today, then your children will only receive shallow well water. And shallow well water tends to have, in my experience, mosquito larvae living in it. That's not good. Deep wells don't have that because they're too deep in the ground. And you've got to pump the water up. Mosquitoes can't get down there. And so there'll be a healthy wellspring of life that comes out of your life. If you dig deep into the things of God. It begins with honouring your mother, your own mother. The passage we read today said this. Children, obey your parents in the Lord. Well, this is right. Honour your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on earth. It's an interesting little statement. If you're willing to honour your mother, do it God's way. Then He's going to give you great enjoyment. And He offers you life in a way that you wouldn't have had it before. Well, I hope you've been a little reflective tonight and thought about motherhood is not a pain. It's not meant to be. It's meant to be a joy. And I would like to suggest to you tonight that motherhood can truly be a joy when it's centred in the one who created us for it. Amen? Let's talk to God. And I'd like you to want to agree with this prayer at the end tonight. When I say all the people said amen, you could say amen. All the people say amen. Like that. Okay? So we're going to talk to God first. You can close your eyes, open your eyes, do whatever you like. There's nothing in the Bible tells you exactly what to do with your face when you pray. Tonight, Lord, we come to you, and for some of us, we realise that points we've failed. In fact, every one of us here will have failed. Some of us here are mums, and some of us are potential mums, and we want to really do the right thing from tonight, even if we haven't at times in the past. Help us to be aware of what you're trying to say to us. Help us to be people who have our hearts after the way that you would design us to raise our children. Help us to be able to put right the things that have gone wrong in the past too, Lord. We want to say sorry that we didn't listen to you at times. And show us how to listen. For those of us with young children and teenagers that are growing up, Lord, teach us how to be teachable. Teach us how to teach. Teach us how to pray with our children. Teach us how to live a life that's of value to you. Because when it's of value to you, it's of value to our children. So guide us, we pray in Jesus' name. And Lord, we also want to pray for those of us who need me and women. We pray a blessing on our mothers. For those that are still alive, Lord, we really pray that you'll touch them with your love, even this day. And that you might even use us as agents of your love. Help us to be like you, we pray in Jesus' name. And all the people said,
amen.
And all the people said,
amen.
Well, may the Lord bless you. Let's give a hand. There's such a wonderful involvement by children. Let's give them the same love. Wonderful week, and if there's things that you want to do for your mothers, go and do it.